Welcome. Welcome. I'm Victor Curran, president of the Friends of the Concord Free Public Library, and on behalf of the Friends, I'm delighted to welcome you to the 18th annual presentation of the Ruth Ratner Miller Award for Excellence in American History. This year's laureate is Robert Dallek, historian of the American presidency, which is a subject that is very much on my mind these days and probably yours too. The Miller Award was offered to the Concord Library by Concord resident Richard Miller to honor the legacy of his mother, a founding member of the Holocaust Commission and the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C. Mrs. Miller believed that learning history was not merely desirable, but a civic and religious obligation. Mr. Miller and his sister, Gabrielle, continue to support this special award. The Concord Free Public Library is an extraordinary institution. It's a center of learning, culture, and community building, and it also houses an important collection of manuscripts, records, books, ephemera, and works of art that document the history of Concord for our own citizens and for scholars from around the world. The Friends of the Concord Free Public Library is a 501c3 nonprofit organization that is proud to support the work of the library in our community by funding purchases of books and media, by presenting programs for adults, teens, and children, by supporting library staff professional development, and by providing donated books to area charities, including Open Table and Concord Prison Outreach. We're able to do this through memberships, gifts and donations, and sales of donated books. The next sale, by the way, will be in this room on December 5th and 6th. Before we begin, a couple of housekeeping items. First, please, where is it? Turn off your cell phone. Second, please take note of the emergency exits. I'm not going to tell you how to fasten your seatbelt. Most important, you are invited to join us for a reception and book signing. Books are available for sale over here. And there will be a reception and book signing in the reference room at the conclusion of this evening's program. To introduce our honoree, the Friends of the Library are pleased to welcome Professor Bruce Shulman, the William E. Huntington Professor of History at Boston University. Professor Shulman has been a colleague of Robert Dallek, both at BU and at UCLA. He received his BA in History from Yale and his MA and PhD from Stanford. He's the author of three books, From Cotton Belt to Sun Belt, Lyndon B. Johnson and American Liberalism, and The 70s, The Great Shift in American Culture, Politics, and Society. He's also the editor or co-editor of five other books and is currently at work on a volume for the Oxford History of the United States, covering the years 1896 to 1929. He's a contributor to the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Los Angeles Times, and has consulted on productions by the History Channel, PBS, and ABC News. Professor Shulman's work also includes initiatives to improve the elementary and secondary teaching of history. He was director of the History Project in California and led a Teaching American History grant program that partnered Boston University with the Boston Public Schools. His teaching has been recognized with numerous awards, and student reviews on ratemyprofessors.com call him a fun, engaging, interesting, and awesome professor, the best history professor I've had at BU, hands down. Please join me in welcoming Professor Bruce Shulman.
Well, thank you all very much for being here tonight, and thank you, Victor, for that extravagant introduction. I'm not even the speaker tonight, and yet I'm put in mind of something that Lyndon Johnson said when he would receive similarly over-the-top introductions, he would always say that he wished that his parents could have been there to hear it, because his father would have been proud, and his mother would have actually believed it. In any case, on to the business at hand, because it's truly an honor, and it's my great pleasure to introduce this year's recipient of the Ruth Ratner Miller Award for Excellence in American History. Now, normally, when I am asked to introduce a distinguished scholar, like tonight's speaker, what I would do and what you would expect from me would be to recite an impressive resume of accomplishments. I would very likely mention books published. In the case of Robert Dallek, more than 15 books, including his prize-winning study of Franklin D. Roosevelt's foreign policy, his magisterial two-volume biography of Lyndon Johnson, Lone Star Rising, and Flawed Giant, his authoritative account of the unfinished life and times of John F. Kennedy. I'd also probably mention some of the prestigious awards that he has won, such as the Arthur Ross Book Prize for his book Nixon and Kissinger, Partners in Power. And I might even mention the distinguished appointments that he has held, such as a term as the Harmsworth Professor of American History at Oxford University. But in this case, it seems to me that the normal listing of achievements hardly seems appropriate. It doesn't begin to capture the scope of Robert Dallek's accomplishments or the remarkable character of his career. After all, very few historians can claim to have both won the Bancroft Prize, an award that signals the deep research and archival sources that is a hallmark of Robert Dallek's scholarship, and also to have placed a book at the number one spot on the New York Times bestseller list, a tribute to the accessibility of his prose. Fewer historians still can claim to have eaten dinner 5 times with the sitting president of the United States and to have been linked in print with Monica Lewinsky. And no, not linked in the way that perhaps you were thinking, but when Professor Dallek exposed John F. Kennedy's dalliance with a White House intern, one tabloid newspaper decided to display Ms. Lewinsky's picture alongside of Bob's. His wife could not have been happy about that. Perhaps even fewer scholars can claim to have been trained both in psychoanalysis at the Southern California Analytic Institute and in history at Columbia under the supervision of the legendary American historian Richard Hofstadter. Equally unusually, Robert Dallek has produced both authoritative works of imposing research and, on the model of his mentor Hofstadter, thought-provoking essays about the American political tradition in general. It's quite an impressive biography, and all the more remarkable, I think, that despite the heft of his accomplishments, Bob's work has always displayed a capacity for humor, the kind of playfulness that Hofstadter regarded as one of the true engines of intellectual life. Whatever the intellectual is too certain of, if he is healthily playful, wrote Hofstadter, he begins to find it unsatisfactory. The meaning of his intellectual life lies not in the possession of truth, but in the quest for new uncertainties. Continuing that quest tonight, it's my great honor to present a 2015 recipient of the Concord Library's Ruth Ratner Miller Award for Excellence in American History, Robert Dallek.
Thank you so much, and Bruce, thank you for that wonderful introduction. I must tell you, I like it a lot more than when I got about, 30 years ago when I was lecturing in the Soviet Union. My host on that occasion, who I like to think had an imperfect command of English, introduced me by saying, Professor Dallek is the author of several distinguished works. They're the kinds of books that once you put them down, you can't pick them up again. Not music to an author's ears. I also love to begin these talks with what I consider a lovely anecdote about my son, who is also a published historian and teaches at George Washington University. When he was about 4 years old, he said to me one day, "Daddy," said, "you're a doctor, aren't you?" I said, "Well, yes, but not like your doctor, not like your pediatrician." He said, "Oh, I know that because you're also an historian." Well, I was delighted he could make this distinction. But then he wanted to know, "Does that mean that you make people in the past feel better?" Now let's see if I can do that for any of these characters I'm going to talk about tonight. You know, a couple of days ago, Tom Friedman had an article in the, an op-ed in the New York Times, in which he speculated on the question of why it is that anyone would run for the presidency. Because, as you saw, I'm sure, this week, the barrage of questions that Hillary Clinton confronted in that Benghazi hearing, at the end of which the chairman said, "Well, we learned nothing new." And but it's really, I think, an example of how difficult that presidential office is, how difficult it is to run for that job and to hold it. In fact, the most striking evidence to me of the problem that we have in this country with sustaining presidential leadership is the fact that we now have 44 presidents. Obama is number 44. And how many of those have been elected to a second term? Only 17. Only 17 have been elected to a second term. And only Obama will be only the 14th to have completed 8 years in office or more, because Lincoln and McKinley were both assassinated, and of course, Richard Nixon was forced to resign. So imagine, only 14 with Obama's completion of his term to have served 8 years in the office. It's because in part, that there is a constant drumbeat of attack, of negativism about the people who hold the office. In 1800, Thomas Jefferson was attacked as the Antichrist. John Adams was called an hermaphrodite, half man, half woman. Andrew Jackson, they attacked him as a bigamist. Abraham Lincoln, probably the greatest of our presidents, came in for this extraordinary series of attacks. They called him the original gorilla. They said he was a ghoul. He was a two-faced liar. And Lincoln, who had a wonderful sense of humor, replied, "Do you think if I had another face, I would stay with this one?" Ulysses S. Grant, they said, "The progress of the presidency from Washington to Grant was evidence enough to disprove Darwin's theory of evolution." Grant was a Neanderthal. He should have been extinct for ages, you see. And it went on from there. William Howard Taft was called a rat in the corner, you see. Franklin Roosevelt was attacked as a demented cripple in a wheelchair, you see. Harry Truman, when he ran into all sorts of problems in 1946 and 47, the slogan from the Republicans was, "To err is Truman," you see. Lyndon Johnson, I interviewed Mrs. Johnson for those volumes I did, and she told me about the young people who would march around the White House shouting, "Hey, hey, LBJ, how many kids did you kill today?" And she said it was a wound in his heart. It so hurt him, you see. So what you've had is this constant barrage of attacks on these men who filled the office. And what you see now in this campaign is that there's one candidate, I'm sure you know who he is, I won't mention his name, but all he can do is talk in negative ways and praise himself. He's going to make America great again. How will he do it? The job is so difficult, but this doesn't stop him. And of course, people want this. They want to hear positive things. You know, when Jimmy Carter gave that malaise speech, it so undermined him. And Reagan gained so much when he spoke about mourning in America and the pride is back, you see. So this constant barrage of attacks. Now, I think that, and I'll talk about this in a couple of minutes, I think that the most effective presidents in American history have in their backgrounds struggles with personal, physical, and emotional difficulty, you see. Go back to Theodore Roosevelt. He had a great deal of difficulty as a child, all sorts of health problems, you see. Franklin Roosevelt, of course, overcame polio. And it at the end of the day, it served him brilliantly because he hid from the country the fact that he was still compelled to walk with crutches or walk with the support of someone whose arm he was hold. And the impression he gave was that he had recovered from his polio. And it was brilliantly effective in the midst of the Depression because people identified with him and identified with the fact that he had recovered, or the idea that he had recovered, and the hope was that he could now bring recovery to the country, you see. But it was a tremendous ordeal for him to have surmounted that difficulty to achieve the presidency. Others have struggled as well. John F. Kennedy, what I found when I did the research for that Unfinished Life, I got into his medical records. It's very unusual for a historian to get into a president's medical records. I tried to get into Johnson's medical records. They're locked up in the clinic in Minnesota. I tried to get into Richard Nixon's medical records. They're locked up in his library for 75 years, you see. So who knows, 70 years from now, whatever it is, when they release them, we'll find out some additional interesting things about Nixon that even go beyond the tapes that we have available to us. So they struggle mightily, and they have to overcome these difficulties. And Eisenhower overcame a heart attack. Lyndon Johnson overcame a big heart attack when he was in the United States Senate. Reagan overcame the fact that he had an alcoholic father. And so I think they're steeled somehow to deal with the office of president, because you have to have an awfully thick skin. Now, I don't mean to campaign for anybody, but I watched that Benghazi hearing the other day, and it was impressive what Hillary Clinton could stand up to, you see. I think she'll make a fine president, given how she is able to deal with that kind of barrage of negativism. Anyway, even with their capacity to deal with these difficulties, there has to be, it seems to be, something more that goes far to explain why they can succeed in the office, why they can get second terms, why they can have a record of achievement and a legacy. So let me point to six things that I see as essential to presidential effectiveness in the course of their administration. First of all, I would say, is vision. Nobody can be a truly effective president in this country, I don't think, unless they have some grand vision. And more important, not only do they have to have a grand vision, but they have to find a way to communicate it to a mass public, see. Theodore Roosevelt did it when he coined the phrase, what? The square deal, see. And the government talking about the strength of the federal government, see. Woodrow Wilson spoke about the new freedom, you see. And for Roosevelt, it was the New Deal. And Harry Truman called it the Fair Deal. And also, of course, Truman had the containment idea, which resonated brilliantly with people during the Great Depression. John Kennedy had the New Frontier. Lyndon Johnson, his principal aide, told him, Richard Goodwin, that he should call his administration the Good Society. But Lyndon, being Lyndon, he said it had to be the Great Society. More about him in a few minutes. Reagan had something he called the Reagan Revolution. Now, as Bruce mentioned, I've been lucky enough to have dinner 5 times with President Obama. He likes to speak to presidential historians. There are about 8 of us. He's invited repeatedly to dinner. And at the first dinner in 2009, we spoke about this idea of needing some kind of catchphrase, some bumper sticker that would capture the public's imagination. And my dear friend, Doris Kearns Goodwin, was sitting next to me at dinner. And remember the slogan Obama had? Probably not. It's called the New Foundation. And Doris leaned over and whispered to me, she said, shaking her head, it sounds like a woman's girdle. So he's never come up, and we've not been able to help him with coming up with a compelling catchphrase that could make it that much more appealing to people. You know, the greatest visionary among presidents in the country's history, I think, was Woodrow Wilson, because he spoke of a war to end all wars and to make the world safe for democracy. Now we know, this was almost ludicrous to speak of a war to end all wars, you see. But to this day, I think Wilson has a reputation as a great American president for a number of reasons. But I think what's so central to this is the issue of the vision he enunciated of ending war and making the world safe for democracy, so much so that George W. Bush seized upon that with the idea that he was going to make the Middle East safe for democracy, you see. So I think that vision resonates to this day. And so when you become president, you need to have some kind of vision that's going to strike resonant chords, because Americans want optimism. They want to think there's a better day ahead. Second, beyond vision, I would say an essential ingredient of effective leadership is charisma, or the power of presidential personality. Theodore Roosevelt in the 20th century was first to capture the public's imagination with his personality. He was the first one to hold press conferences. And he used his family. He had a large family at the White House. And people kind of got caught up in this whole idea that he was one of them, that he was a family man who they could identify with. Woodrow Wilson. Wilson gave speeches that people said were so lyrical, you could have danced to them. FDR. He was the most charismatic of the 20th century. And he gave those wonderful fireside chats. He'd sit in front of that microphone. He was the one who pioneered the use of radio, you see, to reach out to millions of Americans. And people think that he gave dozens and dozens of those. In fact, there are only 30 fireside chats. He would give them on a Sunday night. And he would say that he'd sit before that microphone, he'd close his eyes, and he would imagine himself sitting in the living room with you. And people responded to that. they thought of him as paterfamilias, as somebody who was concerned about them. And if you read the letters, fine Berkeley historian Lawrence Levine once published a collection of the letters that, partial collection, because they're massive, of letters that came into the White House addressed to Roosevelt. They would write him, dear buddy, dear pal, you see. Someone address him as your sire, your royal highness. I mean, I don't think they were being sarcastic either. But he had this compelling way of speaking on the radio and of connecting to people, and it meant a great deal to them. Now, beyond Roosevelt, you come to Harry Truman. In 1948, Harry Truman, nobody thought he could win the presidency. You know, they said to Ernest Truman, his administration's a failure. Now, he had the good luck to be running against Governor Thomas Dewey of New York, who was a very stiff-backed character. And people said he was the only man who could strut sitting down. Somebody said he looked like the bridegroom on the wedding cake. Anyway, when he ran in 1948, he had the shrewdness to take the train across the country and go to all what the Taft of Ohio called, Robert Taft called these whistle stops. And that insulted people in these small communities. But Truman understood that this was a way to connect with people. And he'd go out on the back of that train. And if it were late at night, he'd come out in his pajamas and bathrobe, you see. And he talked to them, sort of shoulder to shoulder, arm to arm, or whatever, and they'd start yelling to him, give him hell, Harry, give him hell. And he said later, I was giving him a bit of heaven, and they thought I was giving them hell. But he, of course, won that presidential election in 1948. It's the greatest upset in American presidential history, you see. And of course, we have that wonderful photograph of him holding up the Chicago Tribune, which said, Truman out, Dewey in, and Truman is standing there holding this up with a, pardon my French now, a big shit-eating grin on his face. He just loved it, you see, that he won out. Beyond Truman, you had Eisenhower. Remember those campaign buttons? I like Ike, you see. And Eisenhower pretended to be above politics. He was a very shrewd politician, and only later did we get some writing and scholarship that revealed the extent to which he was in command of his own administration. But people liked the idea because you see, as we're seeing in this election, people don't have a great deal of admiration or love for politicians. And Eisenhower was able to strike resonant chords with folks in this country because they saw him as a general, commanding general, successful military leader who wasn't really a politician, and that served him greatly. John Kennedy. Kennedy, the youngest man ever elected to the White House, he changed presidential contests in this country as the first Catholic to win the White House. In fact, I see a direct line from Kennedy to Obama, and if Hillary wins the presidency, a direct line to her. Because what he did was to open up the possibility of who could be nominated and who could run for that office. And of course, his moment in the limelight when he had the first televised debate with Richard Nixon, and people who listened to it on the radio thought Nixon had won, and the great majority who saw it on television thought Kennedy had won. Nixon was tired, he had been ill, he had been in the hospital, and somebody said he looked like a sinister the chipmunk. And the mayor of Chicago said he looked like they had embalmed him before he died. Anyway, people saw it on television, and Kennedy, it created a connection to him instantly. And they loved the fact that he was so young and so attractive, you see. And into the bargain, he later held live televised press conferences. He was the first one to do it. And people in his administration told him, don't do it. You could make errors of judgment and it would hurt you. But he knew that television was his ally. And so he was extraordinarily effective at using his image and using his youth to strike resonant chords. Reagan had this stage presence and this command of audiences with a kind of personal appeal. And he wrote in his memoir about the way he could get on the stage and almost anything he would say, he'd get a mass of the audience following him, following his leadership. Let me give you one example of the reverse, the negative. My friend Lyndon Johnson, it wasn't just Vietnam that ought to cut his presidency terribly. And of course, it's a tragic story because the achievements he had in domestic affairs exceeded anything except maybe for Roosevelt. And even there, it's competitive. So, civil rights and voting rights are the two greatest pieces of social legislation, I think, in the country's history. Medicare, an incredible program. These will never be thrown out because the people are so committed and drawn to these social programs. But Johnson had a reputation as a terrible vulgarian, that the stories would go the rounds. Did you ever see those photos of him picking up his beagle dogs by the ears? And he would say, didn't hurt them none. But people were offended by it and thought that he was cruel. They also heard the stories about how he would drive around his Texas ranch at a breakneck speed, come to a grinding halt, jump out of the car, and go to the rear of the car, his limousine or whatever it was, and start urinating on the ground. And a couple of the Secret Service guys came running up to protect him. You know, he's out in the open there. And one of them is supposed to have said to Johnson, Mr. President, you're urinating on my leg. And Johnson said, I know, son, that's my prerogative. I'll just tell, I can keep you here for all night telling you Lyndon stories. But one more was that he had to be the best. He had to top everybody. Everett Dirksen, Republican minority leader from Illinois, he got a car telephone for his limousine. And he called Johnson up because Johnson was the first one to get a car telephone for his limo as the Senate majority leader. And Dirksen called him up and he said, Lyndon, I wanted you to be the first one I called on my new car telephone. And Johnson said, can you hang on a second, Ev? My other phone is ringing. He had to top everybody. So, vision, charisma, a third element, I would say, of great presidential leadership is pragmatism. Good old-fashioned practical politics. Two of the great masters of that in the 20th century were FDR and Lyndon Johnson. FDR, when he ran against Hoover in 32, Hoover criticized him as being a chameleon on plaid, which captured something really quite accurately, because he was all over the map. Remember, this is in the day before television, the internet, you know, the kind of immediate 24/7 news cycle, you see. Roosevelt had this pragmatic streak. In 32, when he ran for president, the protective tariff was a significant issue. And he told his speechwriters to write a high tariff and a low tariff speech. And he goes out on the hustings, and they get to an area that's high tariff, gives a high tariff speech, low tariff area, gives a low tariff speech. So he finally gets to an area that's mixed. And they said, what are we gonna do? And so Roosevelt said to him, he was governor at the time, he said, I'll show you. He gets out of the back of that train and he gives a talk and mentions protective tariff. At the end of the talk, those in the audience who were for high tariff thought he was for high tariff. And those in the audience who were for low tariff thought he was for low tariff. And that's the definition of a goddamn good politician, you see, which he was. Brilliant politician. Johnson was also an extraordinary politician. Have any of you ever heard these Johnson tapes? You see, on Saturday afternoon in Washington, D.C., C-SPAN radio plays the tapes, Kennedy, Johnson, Nixon, and Johnson talking to these folks in Congress, you see. He was a master of this kind of manipulation. His favorite anecdote, which he used to tell about himself, was that Richard Nixon went to Latin America in 1958, Caracas, Venezuela, where he was stoned, spat upon, and came back to Andrews Air Force Base for a hero's welcome. And Johnson, being Senate Majority Leader, was out there shaking his hand, embracing him. A couple days later, a reporter caught up with Johnson on Capitol Hill and said, "Senator, I saw you out there a couple of days ago embracing Vice President Nixon. I thought you told me a week ago that this guy Nixon was nothing but chicken shit." And Johnson said, "Son, what you gotta understand is that in politics, overnight, chicken shit can turn to chicken salad." The other great pragmatist of the 20th century, believe it or not, was Ronald Reagan. When he was governor of California, he said, "My feet are in concrete on the issue of a withholding tax." See, the state of California had all sorts of fiscal problems, and he signed into law a withholding tax bill. The reporters chided him by saying, "We thought you said your feet were in concrete on that issue." And Reagan said, "Gentlemen, the sound you hear is the concrete breaking about my feet." See? He used humor to counter this kind of criticism. Abortion. He said, as he ran for governor, he was against abortion. He signed into law the most liberal abortion statute of any governor of any state in the United States, you see. So when he got to the presidency, he called the Soviet Union an evil empire. In his second term, he had several meetings with Gorbachev and arrived at a certain amount of, or number of accommodations with the Soviet Union. So he was a practical working politician, so to speak. And so I would say vision and charisma, pragmatism. A fourth thing I point to is trust, credibility. Presidents can lose trust in two ways. They can overreach themselves, as Woodrow Wilson did in promising to make World War I the war to end all wars. Johnson overreached himself by saying that his war on poverty could abolish poverty. It was a bridge too far. They were promising too much. And also, they can be caught out by lying, you see. Richard Nixon held a press conference in which he said to the press, "I am not a crook." It was the day his presidency was over. For a president to have to tell a press conference, "I am not a crook," is really a low moment in the presidency. Johnson, of course, lost his hold on the public over Vietnam because he kept promising light at the end of the tunnel. And one wit said, "Sometimes the light at the end of the tunnel is from an onrushing train." See, Johnson ended up with what was known as the credibility gap. How do you know when Lyndon Johnson's telling the truth, pulls his earlobe, rubs his chin, he's telling the truth? When he begins to move his lips, you know he's lying. It was ruinous. He didn't think it was funny, of course, but it was ruinous to him. Fifth, I would say, is consensus. The greatest presidents have been able to create a national consensus. This is so difficult to achieve. Roosevelt led the country, the Depression, the conflict in the 1920s between modernism and fundamentalism. It was a bitterly divided country. And Roosevelt's New Deal created a consensus. And he also worked very hard to create a consensus for internationalism during World War II. He hid from the public his honest feelings about his doubts, is a better word, his doubts about the Soviet Union. And in 1944, he and Churchill signed an aide memoir to hide the secret of the atomic bomb from Joseph Stalin, from the Soviets. He didn't trust them. But in public, he said, essentially, the future held a love fest, because this is what Americans wanted to hear, and he wanted to promote a consensus for internationalism. Remember, the country had been bitterly isolationist. So those who create a kind of consensus, it really it is a tremendous attribute in achieving a successful presidency. Finally, I would say, there's nothing like a little good old-fashioned luck. See, Napoleon once said, give me generals who know something about tactics and strategy, but best of all, give me generals who are lucky, you see. And FDR was lucky, as somebody said to him, it's a great thing that you're following Herbert Hoover, see. And Reagan was lucky in that he followed Jimmy Carter, because Carter did not have a reputation as a successful president. So anyway, here we are in 2015, on the edge of yet another election. And you know, sometimes I despair about the state of our politics and the presidency and the difficulties. And we talked to President Obama about the issue of how do you deal with this 24/7 news cycle. And Mrs. Obama happened to be at this dinner, and we said, can you go to Camp David to escape for a while? And she said, he's an urban guy. He doesn't like going there, you see. Anyway, the last anecdote I'll tell is that the one dinner she was at, you can see I'm not a shy guy. I did a fair bit of talking at that dinner. And she apparently really liked what I said, because afterwards she came up and gave me a hug and a kiss. She's a very nice, warm woman. He's a cool customer. I sat next to him twice at dinner, and there's never any small talk. He's really, he's very smart, and he's interesting. And it's like being with another academic in a seminar. Anyway, it's going to be interesting to see his memoir, because I'm sure he's a brilliant writer. He will write an interesting memoir. And, you know, to cheer you up at the end, I will say that despite everything, what's so amazing is how well this country does. Because, you know, it's an extraordinary country with an extraordinary political system. And for all its flaws, we manage to keep going. I say, I wish I could come back in 200 years to see what's happened to America and the world. But even with my own grandiosity, I don't think I can arrange that one. Anyway, thanks for being so attentive. Oh, sure. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I'm happy to.
Time for a couple questions?
Sure. Ma'am.
You forgot to mention first ladies.
True.
I think the person you marry has so much importance.
You know, I'll respond by saying that there's all this talk now of changing the portrait on the $10 bill. And I am lobbying with a dear friend of mine who has much more political clout than I do to put Eleanor Roosevelt on the $10 bill. She was the greatest first lady in American history, you see. She accomplished so much. And you know, I don't think FDR could have done it without her. She was a mainstay. And you know, Jackie Kennedy was very important. And also, one must acknowledge, these first ladies have to put up with a lot of crap. I mean, you know, JFK was a compulsive womanizer. I was just told the other day by somebody from the archives that there is a page that it's never been released to historians, but a page on which Kennedy was doodling, and he made a list of all the women he ever had. I'd like to get my hands on that. I could get another bestseller out of it, probably. But anyway, you know, they're not first ladies like presidents. They're not all equal in their achievements. And so I think Eleanor was really just far and away the best. And I'm very hopeful that she will have her portrait on the... And also, you know, we're going to see a woman as president very soon. I don't know if Hillary will win, though I tell my students, never bet a nickel on American politics, but if I had to bet, I'd bet on her. I think she has a damn good chance of winning. And I think she'll make a fine president. And Bill will be that back in the background there. He will love it. And I'll just tell you one last story, quick story. I met Bill Clinton once, and I had a former student who was his radio communications director, and she said, why don't you come to the White House, listen to him, give one of his tape talks. And I said, may I bring my family with me? And my son, my daughter, my wife. She said, oh, yes. So we came, and we lined up after the talk to go into the Oval Office. There were about 40 or 50 of us. And my student said, stay in the back of the line. You'll get a chance to talk to him more when you get up there. So we got up close to him and finally shook his hand. He had read my books. I gave him an autographed copy. And he asked my wife what she did, and my daughter and my son. And anyway, my son and my wife and I were all bubbling when we walked away because he was so charming and engaging. And my daughter didn't say anything. And she's a very perceptive person. I said to her, Rebecca, what did you think? She shook her head. She said, he's a slimy politician. And I said to her, why do you say that? Because she watched him handling some of the young women as they came through the line. This was 2 years before the Monica business. Yes, sir.
Your pragmatism on the one hand and trust on the other, it's so obvious, the tension, the conflict there.
Good point.
How one can...
Right. How do you do
be
it?
...be victim of yep. the other.
Yeah.
Your tale, particularly of the flip-flops right. or all these very successful...
Well, I'll tell you how I think presidents are able to manage that, and they do manage it. If you come across to people as an opportunist, this is very negative. Then they don't have a high opinion of you. But if you come across as pragmatic, that is, you're doing this in the service of your larger ideas and hopes for the country, then I think they're more accepting of it. And also, the power of presidential personality, when they like someone, they're ready to forgive all sorts of things. You see, what's happening in this Republican contest now is this Carson guy is forging ahead, is moving to the front of the line. And I think it has a lot to do with the fact that people find him soft-spoken and pleasant. And I think they're beginning to be put off by the abrasiveness of the some of the other candidates, see. So that goes very far to, now, it hardly is a reason to put somebody in the Oval Office, but it counts for a lot with people because, you know, that old saying, who would you like to have a beer with, you see? And I don't find that a very wise test for putting somebody into the Oval Office, but it counts a lot these days. So I think it's, don't be an opportunist, but be seen as a pragmatist. Yes, ma'am.
How would you rate Obama on the 5 or 6 characteristics,
yeah.
and maybe Bill Clinton too?
Yeah. Well, you know, I take some refuge here by quoting the British historian Arnold Toynbee, who said, the historian trying to understand the present is like the man with his nose pressed against the mirror trying to see his whole body. See? And it's difficult to say. There's going to be a lot written about Obama. But, you know, I can talk at length about these presidential libraries, of which I'm a great fan of. And it usually takes 40, 50 years after someone leaves the White House for us to get to the records. To wit, Ronald Reagan has been out of office now for what, going on 30 years? 75% of his national security files are still closed, see. We need those files. I mean, there's some good journalism on each of these people, and I know two journalists in Washington who are writing about Obama, and I'm sure they're gonna produce fine books, but it's gonna take 30, 40 years. Of course, it also is fortuitous. Depends on who comes next. If the next president falls on their face, Obama's gonna look much better. If the next president is usually successful, it'll in some ways diminish Obama's standing. See, Obama profited enormously from the stumbles that George W. Bush had, you see. And remember, Obama's campaign slogan was about hope, hope. And Bill Clinton used that too. Remember, where was he born? In Hope, Arkansas, you see. So it's a very appealing sort of, but I mean, first of all, Obama will, of course, be remembered forever as the first African-American president. That goes without saying. His problems with the Congress, his difficulties in achieving a consensus, you know, this has been a real struggle for him. So we'll see where, and of course, if the Affordable Care Act remains in place, he's going to get a lot of positive credit for that. But if you got a Republican administration that repealed that, it's going to have an impact on his legacy, on how people see him. So I'm sorry to beg your question, but...
Maybe take one more?
Sure. You choose.
a lot of hands up. Hand up in the back there for a while.
I can change the subject. Program notes say that your latest book, Camelot's Court, illuminates...
Yeah.
Among other things, how Kennedy found himself disappointed by his brain trust. Could you talk a bit about that?
Sure. You know, Kennedy was very disappointed in the advice he got over the Bay of Pigs. It stung him terribly. And he decided, I think at that point, to take his own counsel. Not that he wouldn't listen to advisors. He valued having them around. He valued hearing from them. But at the end of the day, he remembered Harry Truman's proposition, the buck stops here. He was the one who had to make the decision. And the most striking example of it, I think, was during the Cuban Missile Crisis, when he was so reluctant to take military action, to bomb or to invade. And there were several people around him, including people in the Joint Chiefs of Staff, who were pressing him to take that kind of action. And he had the good sense and the wisdom to follow his own counsel. So I think he did have the brain trust, what Roosevelt called the brain trust. He did have this extraordinary group of the best and the brightest. But at the end of the day, he was really following his own counsel. If there was anyone who was close to him, it was Bobby Kennedy. I think Robert Kennedy was the one. And it didn't mean that the president listened to everything he said, you see, because above all, the most important thing I think John Kennedy did was to avoid a nuclear war and to underscore the fact that any president who thinks to use these nuclear weapons will go down in history as a monster, and that he was so frightened of that possibility. And at all costs, he just wanted to avoid that. Not to retreat in the face of aggression or have the United States appear weak in the contest with the Soviet Union, but I think if he had lived, I think he would have passed civil rights. I think he would have done something quite different from what Johnson did in Vietnam. I don't know what he would have done. I don't think he knew himself what he would have done, but I don't think he would have sent in ground troops. He was being pressed during his 1,000 days to put ground troops in Vietnam, and he resisted because he understood that this could be a terribly losing proposition being trapped in those Vietnamese jungles, you see. So if he had lived, I think we would have seen detente with the Soviet Union sooner than it came with Richard Nixon and after, because he saw, and he spoke about that publicly, you know, and that test ban treaty that he got, and that famous speech he gave at American University, in which he spoke about the need for us to think differently, think outside the box, think beyond where we've been in this Cold War struggle. So he was, I mean, it was a great tragedy that he was struck down. But again, I come back to my first point, it's such a difficult job. And that's why, in part also, I think, it's very difficult to get 8 years, because after 4 years, people see your flaws. After all, these people are human, and they are limited, and they make mistakes. And there are a lot of people in the country. Tom Wicker, the American, the New York Times columnist, once said, people think that presidents are miracle workers. No, they're not. They're very limited as to what they can do. But we do get a mixture, and there are a lot of them who become nameless, faceless characters, but there are a handful who have achieved, and I think it's well to remember them.
So. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
The Friends are delighted to present the Ruth Ratner Miller Award for Excellence in American History to Robert Dallek. In so doing, we honor Mrs. Miller's commitment to the role of remembrance in our lives, and we acknowledge our library's role in preserving the story of our past. Now, I do want to say something about this, because this has a story behind it.
Good.
When this building, Concord's first permanent library, was built in 1873. It was surrounded by a cast iron fence with these fleur-de-lis finials on the top of the fence posts. They were removed during, or the fence was removed during a renovation in the 1930s. And the fence was discarded, but the finials were saved. And some years later, a tradition was begun and continues today, whereby retiring trustees and others who have made outstanding contributions on behalf of the library are awarded a finial. Professor Dallek, in recognition of the window that you have given the American people into the Oval Office and the men who have made history there, the Friends of the Concord Free Public Library are pleased to present you with this tangible piece of our history and with the 2015 Ruth Ratner Miller Memorial Award.
Thank you.
You and you all are invited to join us now in the reference room for our reception.
Thank you.
There's another part of the award. Thank you so much.
Thank you.